Hi, this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm still here at Green Dreams FL. That's Pete Kanaris. That's Greek YouTube channel. Puts a link down below to his channel down below. The reason for this episode, I made a second episode of Pete's. I normally only make one episode at a place, but because Pete has a commercial nursery here and he grows so many different trees and plants and, more importantly, perennial edible vegetables in pots, I really want to make a second episode just to share with you guys one of the best sources of perennial vegetables in the country that I found. He has a really wide breadth of some of the different varieties, lots of different fruit trees, especially if you're in this zone, this climate zone. Now, I will tell you guys this. Number one, you can't just come here to the nursery to look around or see Pete's property, right? If you're gonna buy like $200 or more in the plants, then you can come and pick them up. And then the other thing is Pete will ship them to you. So that's really cool. Some of the prices that, maybe I'm not gonna mention prices in here, because if you're coming to pick them up, it's one price. But if you have to basically take the plant up, put it on the nursery table, make sure there's no bugs, disease, and then put it in plastic, you know, put stakes in it so that he could ship it, it's gonna cost you guys a little bit more. But I think, you know what, here's what I think. I think that there's no substitute for genetics, right? Some of these plants are super rare, super, you know, super hard to find. Some of them I haven't even seen myself that are available for sale anywheres. So I'm glad that Pete does make them available, even if they're a little bit more expensive, if you have to get them shipped to you. Currently, he is able to ship to most states, certain states like California, Arizona, maybe Texas, maybe a few others he cannot ship to at present time, but maybe by the time this video is out, he's gone through his clearance with APHIS or whoever he has to do so that he can ship to all the different states, but maybe still not Hawaii. All right, let's come into his nursery area and share with you guys, before it gets too dark, some of the plants that I think you guys should get. So as you guys can see, he has many different tables, and this is one of the requirements to be able to ship plants, is you cannot keep the plants on the ground. You must grow them on tables so that different nematodes and bugs and things can't get in there. And he has lots of different ones. Like, because this is not open to public, he doesn't have everything easily labeled. So if you came here, you wouldn't really know what anything is anyways, unless you knew what it was. And this is the one I really like a lot. This is called Aztec Sweet Herb. This is not one I see a lot. His price, you know, here, if you were just coming and buying and picking up $200 or more, would be like $5 per pot, but you got to get $200 worth. So that's like, if you got 41 gallons, that make your $200 minimum. And you know what? At that rate, you would basically have enough plants to put in a whole installation around your house. So, you know, I'm going to tell you guys, you know, I'm pretty tight with my money, but a $5 for a 1 gallon pot is definitely value priced. Now, if he has to ship it, it's gonna cost you guys more. It's gonna cost you guys $12, because now he has to take it off. He has to basically thoroughly inspect to make sure there's no ants, no bugs. He has to basically protect it, put a stake in it, wrap it up, you know, make sure it's gonna be protected when he does ship it to you guys, and then you're gonna have to pay the additional shipping charge. So it might cost $15 to ship and $12 for the plant if you're getting one. And then, of course, if you're shipping plants, you know, maybe if you add a few more, it might not get that much more expensive. But then if you're shipping plants, then you want to really carefully select and choose the ones that you think will stay alive for you and not just plant for one season, then it might not make it due to the frost. All the plants I'm going to be talking about today are some that I could keep alive myself in zone 9A. You may be able to keep it alive if you're in a zone 9B like Pete is able to do here, literally in pots on his nursery tables. Anyways, this one's called Aztec Sweet Herb. It's kind of like, if you know stevia, stevia has that sweet leaf. This also has a nice sweet leaf. This is an uncommon plant I don't often see. And if you were to find this in a nursery pot at your local nursery, it might be, and I've rarely seen these at nurseries, it might be like in a 4-inch pot and they might charge you $3 for it. So Pete, you know, it's charging you $5 for 1 gallon. That's even a better deal for a nice, more established plant. We're going to try this for you. And actually this Aztec sweet leaf has a really good flavor to it. Not a lot of bitter aftertaste like I've tasted on previous plants. Let's go ahead and continue to move before it gets too dark. One of the things I like about the nursery here is that Pete's created basically a natural overstory. So once again, he has a tall tree above, and for some of the plants that like shade, he doesn't put shade cloth up. He just uses the tree above, and he's growing lots of different things, including the aloe, including the katuk that I highlighted in last video. And this is another plant. If you're in like a zone 9A or 9B, you might want to try this plant. It will need protection. It does not like the frost, but this is one amazing plant that I like. He does have this kind, and then he also has a more rare variegated kind with nice affordable prices. Now, this is in a 3-gallon, so it's gonna cost a bit more, and I always wanna encourage you guys, right, to buy the largest pot size you guys can afford, because it's gonna be a healthier plant and a plant that's gonna produce more food for you to eat sooner rather than later. All right, moving right along here. This plant may be available near you, but this is another one of my favorite plants that he has here. This is known as the go-to cola. This is basically a creeper and an amazing ground cover. This will basically decimate and take over a whole area, so please be aware of that. If you are planting it, you gotta have acres. Don't plant this in a raised bed. It'll likely take over your raised bed like it did for me in a zone 9A. But yeah, the go-to cola is good for your memory, good for your brain, and this stuff, I tasted earlier, looks amazing. In addition, if you go down here, he's got the, oh man, this is the Chief Kubu's prize. This is known as the salad tree. This is also a type of hibiscus, right? These guys are totally amazing. If you live in this zone, like a zone 9B, maybe in 9A, depending on your microclimates, you may be able to keep this guy alive year-round. And basically, like this tree, unlike the chai that you have to cook the chai, you could just harvest the leaves like this and just eat them raw. They're completely amazing, a really nice neutral flavor. I grow these every year now. Last year I tried to grow them and I kept it as an annual until it frosted and I lost them. This year I'm gonna try to move them into my greenhouse a bit earlier. Maybe I'll be able to keep these alive. But yeah, I mean, and he has three varieties of these guys, the Chief Kubu's prize salad tree. It's known as bele in the South Pacific, and that's where it's normally from. Another bele plant, or that edible salad tree, is this guy. This is known as the, Kiko's crump, I believe. And this, instead of that more kind of like a segregated leaf, has more like kind of like more larger leaves. So actually, I honestly like to grow this one better because there's actually a lot more leaf area per leaf, a lot more food. But nonetheless, I mean, look at this. I mean, he'll probably be moving these up to the 3 gallon size soon. This is an amazing plant for $5. Like, I order these from another nursery in Florida to get them to me, and they're like this small for even more money than what Pete sells it for. So he's even a better deal. And you know, this one is gonna be a pain to ship, and that's why he charges more when he ships them to you. But yeah, this is one of my favorite leafy greens in the entire world, aside from the katuk. That is actually even easier to grow than the katuk, right? This could handle a little bit of frost, whereas the other one, definitely the katuk will not. All right, and then moving over here, he's got the shiso spinach. This is that spinach that I highlighted in last episode. This is the Brazilian spinach. This plant is extremely rare. I've rarely ever seen this guy for sale, and I'm glad that Pete makes this available. Once again, you know, I think it is all about plant genetics, right? We want to get these plant genetics out to people. If you're not growing this, or you're not growing some other kind of edible ground cover, right? In my opinion, you're wasting space because now you are having to buy some of your food when you could be growing more of your leafy greens. And leafy greens, in my opinion, should be a staple in your diet. I mean, my channel is called Growing Your Greens for a reason, not because I randomly came up with that, not because a URL was available, because I want you guys to grow and eat your greens, whether they're annual greens or even better perennial greens that do better for the planet, and in some cases, even better for you than like a standard iceberg lettuce. Well, yeah, way better than you than a standard iceberg lettuce. So yeah, glad that Pete is here to make these available. Another one of my favorite perennial greens are right over here. Probably my favorite perennial green that actually I grow year round in Las Vegas, Nevada, is the longevity spinach. Once again, you know, if you guys are local, you guys get hooked up because you guys get really nice established plants with actually mulched with leaves, which is something I normally don't see at nurseries, for $5, right? Buy 10 of these, put them in an area every 5 feet, right? In a couple of years, you'll have a whole area of just greens you could eat, you know, and do this as an understory. If you guys already have your permaculture food forest planted out with fruit trees, right? Don't forget the vegetables. Come to Pete's place, order a minimum of $200, show up and pick up a lot of these different edible green plants, such as the longevity spinach, such as the shiso spinach, such as some of the other ones I've showed you guys, to grow even more greens so you guys can eat out of your garden, eat out of your permaculture food forest here in the South Florida, Southwest Florida area, even if you're in the Southeast Florida area, right? I've even seen some of these plants available in the Southeast Florida. Like, why does Southwest Florida usually have better nurseries than Southeast Florida? Like, that just blows my mind. I mean, if I was to move to Florida, maybe I'd even move to this area just because Pete's here and there's so many good resources for people in this area. But yeah, the longevity spinach I keep alive. I plant it on a south, next to a south-facing wall, and all I have to do is cover it with burlap in the wintertime, and normally it makes it, although last year I lost my plants because it got down into 25 and my burlap did not keep it warm enough, so I have to put up Christmas tree lights. I will put a link down below to the video I made how I keep this alive year-round. This is one of my favorite greens of all times because it is so easy, and it's a lot more hardy than some of these other perennial greens that I've experimented with. This is something that if it gets to 33 degrees, it's fine, but at 32, doesn't like it. Some of the other perennial greens, like the moringa tree, that one doesn't like it below 50 degrees based on my experience. So let's go ahead and find a few more greens before it gets too dark. So if you guys like longevity spinach so much, like I do, right? A distant related relative is this guy. This is the Okinawan spinach. And this one may grow better or worse for you. I like this one actually better than the other one because it actually has purple on the back of the leaves, so it like looks more colorful. Some people say this one actually tastes better too, so if you're really into taste, this one might taste better for you guys. But also, this one doesn't like full sun as much in my experience in Las Vegas. I was not able to plant this in full sun. It totally croaked. It didn't make it. Whereas the longevity spinach totally handles full sun. I would plant this more in the shady area. And he also has this guy available. So let's see. Let's go ahead and move on to a few more. Now, this one is more of an annual crop. You know, it's not perennial, not going to live year-round. But what it will do, it will grow, produce these edible leaves. This is known as the Egyptian spinach. So I love to eat the Egyptian spinach. This is like an ancient food from Egypt, right? They used to eat this in the olden days. The Japanese now caught on to this. They grow this and they powder this and they'll sell you in a supplement as like green powder for like, I don't know, $50, 1 pound of this stuff. But why buy it in a powder at the health food store when you guys can grow it? And you guys know if they're selling it at a health food store, it must be healthy for you. And I know most of you guys have never heard this or eaten this. I like the flavor. It's a nice thin leaf. It's not like crunch or gelatinous, more like the longevity that's a little bit more thick. Maybe like a Malabar. And then in addition, it has these seed pods. And many of you guys may not know that if you find a young little seed pod, well, these seed pods will basically mature. It's related to okra. And you'll have tons of seeds. It'll drop seeds. They'll just keep coming back on their own every year. But what many of you guys may not know is that you can actually harvest the little tender young seed pods and eat them. Mmm. And if they're young enough, they're crunchy and they're not fibrous. And they just basically crunch down. This is actually a gourmet delicacy in some high-end restaurants. You know, I know a grower that'll basically just grow these for seed pods and sell like, you know, 10 seed pods for $10 or something like that so they could put them on their frou-frou restaurant dishes. I don't recommend you guys eat this as a frou-frou vegetable. I want you guys to eat this in mass quantity. It's the end of the season here, so these guys are going to pod and setting seed. So they'll basically just come back on their own the next year without you having to replant. All right, last two vegetables I think I want to cover for you guys. Number one are the jewels of au pair. Now, honestly, these guys better start it from seed because seeds are really inexpensive. And it starts from seed fairly well, although if you guys want to buy established plants, once again, if I lived here, $5 for nice established plants. I wouldn't ship one of these guys, I'd ship some of the other ones because the genetics are more rare. But honestly, I mean, these guys are going to seed here, and all I got to do for the seeds is take my hand and go like this. And look at that, I have all the seeds. I wish I had a baggie to put them in. Maybe I'll just shove them in my pocket and put them in a baggie later. But now I can grow this plant, right? So literally, once you buy some of these plants that are propagated by cuttings, such as the katuk, or the longevity spinach, or the Okinawan spinach, or once you buy the jewel of au pair once, you keep them alive, they go to seed, they will reproduce on their own, right? And then when you can spread this plant, you can create your own nursery and start selling your own 1 gallon pots for $5, right, in your area to get these valuable plants out to people. Who's doing it? Can you buy any of these plants at a local plant nursery that's selling the stupid annual vegetables? No, no, no. That's why I want you guys to support Pete so that he can continue his work, continue to spread these rare genetics around the country, around the world, especially to zone 9A and 9B, where they're going to thrive like they are here, and then more people could grow these guys and know about them, because I think a big challenge is the information. People do not know the benefits of these plants, how easy they are to grow. Unlike annual plants, you got to keep replanting, like lettuce and all these things, right? These are more nutritious, taste better, are easily maintained, less bothered by pests, and even more delicious. Now, aside from the jewels of au pair standard green variety, he has a variety that I'd never seen before in my life until I came here, and that's why I like to travel so much, and it's right here. This is the variegated jewels of au pair. So if you guys see this planted in your front yard, right, you might think, oh, that's a nice ornamental, don't eat it, but this is a jewel au pair that's actually variegated, so we can see the same exact kind of seed pods. I think they're coming, oh, here's some that are nice and ripe. We can see if we could get a couple. It just relatively, the seeds come off relatively really easily, and you can just take those and replant them. And also I want to try the leaf for you because I've never tried one of these guys on camera for you guys. I just had the green leaf and it tastes like a nice green leaf, right? Now I will say the variegated leaf, a little bit stronger tasting. So unless you're a green connoisseur and you want to just eat it, I would definitely stick with the non-variegated. But if you really like how this looks and don't mind a little bit stronger flavor, I'd say go with the variegated, it's much prettier. So another thing real quick that I want to show you guys is this is like Pete's production greenhouse, basically where he's starting things from different cuttings and whatnot. Actually, this is the cuttings he did of the katuk here, and I don't know, all different kinds of cuttings from different kinds of plants. I don't even know all of them. So he will propagate many of the plants here himself. He also gets plants from tissue culture, will grow them out bigger and bigger under organic methods, get them bigger. He'll get other trees and plants and just potting them up and keep them healthy, grow them under permaculture slash above organic standards. you know, so then he can provide you guys the healthiest fruit trees and plants you'll find probably here in the state. All right, another cool thing I learned about this trip, because I've never seen this plant before, is this is another edible hibiscus. You can eat the leaves, and check this out. This hibiscus is called hibiscus cannabiscus. And look at that leaf, looks like cannabis. The cannabis leaf, the hemp leaf. No, this is not cannabis hemp. This is the hibiscus cannabiscus with the edible leaves that look like the cannabis leaf. This is not cannabis. Once again, this will not get you high. It has no THC, no CBD to what I'm aware, but it does grow the edible leafy greens that we're gonna eat. Wow, and this has a nice sorrelly flavor. I love my hibiscus plants. Like you saw the belay, that's like related to hibiscus, I believe. Also the cranberry hibiscus that you saw in the last episode, I'll put a link down below to. This one tastes just like those. Looks like they're doing great. I mean, these guys are in 3-gallon pots. This is a new hibiscus that I gotta try to see if it's gonna make it in my neighborhood. All right, so this is probably the last shot I'm gonna get to show you guys of the nursery. You know, I mean, I have no time because as you guys can see, it's getting really dark. I could barely shoot here with the light as it is. But Pete has all different kinds of trees, and this is just one nursery space he has with like more better sun. He has another nursery space with more better sun, and then another nursery space with like more dappled shade. And I can't cover those because it's too dark. I got here too late and we're just having too much fun filming other videos and talking and chatting, right? So he has all different kinds of fruit trees that are gonna be fruitful here in the area. And definitely I would say, you know, it's probably not the best thing to be shipping fruit trees, but if you got to ship a fruit tree, I would definitely say the peach fruit trees here are some of the healthiest I've seen. If you got to order them, because it's gonna cost you money no matter where you order them from. And his prices seem to me, from my perspective, seem to be in line with others. And plus his quality seems to be pretty good. I want to show you guys actually one more fruit tree here that I want you guys to be aware of, because it's something that he has that I'm not aware anybody else has. So these guys may not look the super healthiest right now, but these are actually some guavas. I think Brookfield guavas, and this is actually a naturalized guava that was found here locally, maybe 15 miles away or something like that. And this guy could handle into the 20s, the mid 20s, like multiple days in a row. So if you guys are looking to buy a guava and it gets a little bit too cold and freezes for you, you guys should look into this one and try this one. I don't know how it's gonna do. That's what, you know, Pete is telling me, and I tend to trust Pete. He seems like a honest guy. And so this one will be one of the ones I'm gonna try one of these days to grow a guava that could handle 25 degrees. And I will put it to the test in Las Vegas, where we don't usually get below 25, but we will get below freezing on most, you know, winters. Although that being said, I'll plant this in the warm area of my garden that I do end up protecting, probably next to my longevity spinach, right? But yeah, and so this guava is like a yellow guava with the white flesh. Although the negative, although it can handle the cold weather, the negative is it's a little more seedy than other guavas. But you know what? Seeds are good. You can spread the seeds, you can grow the seeds, you can eat the seeds, they'll go right through you, and they'll be instantly fertilized, all right? So I think the last part of this episode, what I wanna do is actually we're gonna go ahead and sit down with Pete and ask him a few questions about Pete's nursery. All right, so now we're here with Pete Kanaris of Green Dreams FL. He has that YouTube channel I want you guys to check out. Link is down below. But Pete, I got to visit your nursery and share that, some of my favorite plants with people. And honestly, why did you even start a nursery? Because you were in the landscaping business, actually the service industry, and now you're kind of getting into the plant industry and selling plants, and it's a lot to manage. I know you even had to bring on staff to manage your huge nursery with thousands of plants, and thousands of my favorite plants. I wish I was you and had all these plants myself.
I honestly didn't want to, John, to be honest with you. It's just, it was one of those things, the options weren't available. There's not enough people out there doing the perennial vegetables, there's not enough fruit tree nurseries. There's not a lot of people doing it to my standards, you know. I mean, there's nobody else, to my knowledge, maybe other than a couple small-scale nurseries doing it organically. You know, I go to these nurseries and pick up these trees, and I see these brown dead weeds in the pots that were evidently sprayed with herbicide. So, you know, when they spray the herbicide, they're spraying the mat, they're spraying the ground around it, they're spraying inside the pot. You know, you can see the granulars of the synthetic fertilizers on top of the pots. I mean, who knows what they're spraying on top of these trees. It's just, you know, they're growing huge thousands and thousands of trees, a monoculture of one type, you know. So a lot of the times it's like taking a bodybuilder off steroids, you know, bringing this plant back, weaning it off of the chemical fertilizers and giving it compost teas and organic fertilizers. And, you know, if there was somebody else out there doing it, I probably wouldn't be growing as much. But unfortunately, you know, we had to just kind of bring all that stuff in the house, you know. So, yeah, we have a staff now. We have two full-time girls out there. You know, we're shipping plants. We're doing everything. And a lot of it's just to have on hand, you know, when we go to do this job, because I can't find it. And I'm still sourcing. I still have to call a native nursery, you know. So a lot of our installs are you know, 70% edibles. The other 30% are beneficial, predatory, and native plants. You know, so it's about creating that whole ecosystem.
Yeah, so in this video, I pretty much focus on the edible plants because it's the ones I'm most interested in. But of course, if you are doing a permaculture install, yes, we got edible plants important for us, but definitely don't forget about the edible plants for the insects, for the beneficial insects, and for the native and wildlife creatures to create a whole habitat and, more importantly, ecosystem near you. Pete, so here's one thing that's interesting I find about you is that, you know, you want competition. You want more competition. If somebody bought one of your plants, like the Janiera Procommons or the Janiera Bicolor, the Longevity Spinach or the Okinawan Spinach, they bought that. They could literally take cuttings off that, stick it in dirt, and then grow their own plants, and then they could start selling and competing against you. Why would you welcome that?
I mean, it's not competition. There's room for plenty of us, you know, and I want them to share it with their friends. I want them to share it with their neighbors because at the end of the day, this isn't about just making money. It's about inspiring people and teaching people and getting people excited about plants. And when you grow a plant like a perennial vegetable or a fruit tree, and you know, which are usually pretty easy to grow, I mean, yeah. You know, that when you have success, you know, that's when you have fun. You know, when you have the failures and you're growing the harder to grow stuff, you know, like the annuals, which can be a little bit tougher. let's face it, you know, they're a little bit needier. They need a little bit more water.
Could be,
yes, you know. So when you're getting into the perennials, you know, I think that there's just this easy to grow excitement, you know, like you tell somebody about moringa, like I sell a moringa tree to somebody, he's gonna bring that tree home, maybe get seed, share it with his neighbor. If he wants to start a moringa nursery, I can't tell you how many moringas I've sold that people that are selling moringas now. I think that's great, you know, the idea is to get the plant out. There's, you know, we don't have scarcity out there. There's enough room for everybody in this plant game, and the more people that get excited, the more people are gonna get into it. And I wish there was, you know, 100 nurseries like mine around the state of Florida.
Yeah, absolutely. Me too. I wish there were actually nurseries like Pete's in every state, although some of the plants aren't going to do well in every state in the country. And, you know, likewise, you know, I think instead of like, oh, I want the biggest piece of the pie. No, we need to make the pie bigger so that everybody is into this and the industry could support. And all your neighbors had Janiera Procommons and Janiera Bicolor growing, right? We want these out. We want these out like fast food chains, man, are getting in every corner. We want like, I want perennial nurseries and nurseries growing food crops on every corner and get it to be that popular. And I think the challenge is most Americans simply, unfortunately, do not care about growing their own food because for them, they have that grocery store, right? They can buy food at the grocery store. Why do they need to grow their own? So Pete, why should people grow their own food, especially if they're in a climate here like Florida, instead of go to the grocery store and be a slave to, you know, the trucking companies and the mass food, giant food corporations?
Well, I think there's a number of reasons, you know, other than just cutting down on a carbon footprint, but I think it's like knowing where your food comes from.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Knowing it came out of your front yard. You know, there's something about getting your hands in the dirt and touching something that you grew and actually eating something that you grew. You know, not only are these foods typically way more nutritious, they're grown in healthier soils. I mean, you know, even on organic agriculture, I mean, those soils are typically, you know, crap from what I've seen. You know, I mean, I've seen organic certified farms growing in pure sand. You know, I think there's something to say about something growing in your backyard and some living soil, and you even getting your hands out there in the dirt yourself. It's rewarding. It's like a, you know, obviously a natural antidepressant in a way. You know, it makes you happy when you get out there and start working with the plants, and then to actually taste it, it's like I think it kind of makes everything come full circle. You know, so the nutritional benefits, the mental benefits. I think there's so many different benefits that come in from growing these things yourself, you know, that it goes beyond what money could buy.
Yeah, cool. And let's talk about this. Like, I mean, a lot of nurseries I visit, like they don't ship. You got to go there to buy the plants, but you actually will ship your plants to people around the country. Like, so do you want to talk about shipping plants and the process you go through and why it costs more to ship a plant than if somebody came here? Like, why do I got to pay more money, Pete, if you got to ship it to me? And including A, you got to pay the shipping costs.
Well, the big part is A, we have to dry the plants out a bit before we ship them. So we get the order, we'll pull the plant, we'll dry it out to cut down on that shipping cost when it's still pretty high. You know, we check the plant for any type of ants or bugs. We can't ship with any of that type of stuff, or, you know, all of a sudden we'll be put on a list that you're banned on. You know, we have to pack the plant in the box to where it won't shift around in the box. The soil won't come out of it. It's a whole process. It makes it about, you know, 10 times harder than just somebody coming and pick up the plant, or actually me delivering them to them. So it's a bit of a process. But it's, you know, at the end of the day, there's not too many other people selling these plants. So it's still worth it. You know, we try to get them out at an affordable price.
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely say that it's, I mean, that's a lot of work. I wouldn't want to do all that work because trust me, I've packed plants to take on the airplane through the TSA and just that alone takes me a lot of time. So I could not imagine handing the plant in a box where the UPS or FedEx or, you know, postal service might tip it upside down and like mess it up and it has to arrive in good shape to the people, how much extra time, money, and effort that will take. So yes, I definitely think it's worth it. And the other thing I mentioned earlier in the video is that, you know, it's about the plant genetics. Yes, it may cost a little bit of money, but even so, some of Pete's plants with his packing is cheaper than a nursery that I went to in Southern California to buy an 8-inch pot and a $30 plant just to get the genetics because I wanted it so bad. I mean, his plants are like 12 bucks in a 1 gallon, which, and then, you know, he's got to ship it to you, which might end up be about 30 bucks, but then it's going right to your door.
They don't have to leave home.
That's and it. They don't got to leave home, so you're going to get those genetics. And once you have those genetics, hopefully also you're going to appreciate the plant more because it costs you more money and you're going to make sure it stays alive so you don't lose your investment of the shipping and the cost and all the work that the Pete has done or his people at the nursery have done to get that plant to you in a healthy state. So, I mean, once again, I would not really complain about the price. And plus, you bring these rare plant genetics, some of the plants I haven't seen anywhere else that will ship to you. So that's totally amazing. So I want to appreciate you and thank you that you're doing that. And then the other thing is, if you're local, you can't just come to his nursery to buy plants. You want to talk more about this?
Yeah, so we do live in a neighborhood. I can't legally, you know, have a business here with hours of operation. I am zoned agriculture, so I have a legal nursery. We have a green belt for having that on the property. But for the most part, I offer plant delivery. And on larger orders over $200, you know, by appointment only, we do some pickup.
So on delivery, like, would you deliver to, like, I don't know, Tampa if somebody ordered one plant? Or how does that work?
We have a minimum $200 on the delivery.
Okay, also. So $200 on delivery, and then you charge a delivery charge. Is it free?
Within 20 miles, it's 45 bucks.
All right, so cool. So if you order 200, they'll deliver for 45 bucks. Or if you order 200, you could come and pick up. And then how do people know what you have for sale?
We have a PDF on our website, which has pretty much a complete list of everything. Our inventory is fairly up to date. We just went through it recently.
And then if somebody's online, can they just go to a website and order if they want to order like a single plant to get shipped to them? How would they do that?
Yeah, from my website, you're going to get taken over to our shopping cart, which is
through Shopify. So you do have a shopping cart with all your inventory on there as well.
Yeah, with Shopify. So I have a full PDF on the website of lists that you would actually be able to get for pickup. And then the Shopify has the plants that are available on a monthly basis, whether it be cuttings or plants for shipping.
Ah, so some plants won't be able to ship to people.
Exactly. Like our bigger trees that you're going to see on our PDF. You know, 7 gallon material, like we don't ship anything over 3 gallon material.
So the 1 gallons and 3 gallons that I showed in this episode should pretty much be available for shipping unless maybe you're like low on inventory.
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Perfect. Great. Wonderful. All right. So Pete, is there anything else people should know about your nursery here and the plants that you're offering?
I'd say you only tapped into about 5% of it out there.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it got too dark too fast. I mean, it just pitch black outside. I was getting eaten by mosquitoes because the mosquitoes love my Las Vegas blood.
No, we've got about 17,000 plants in stock. We've got about, I'd say, a little over 2 acres of nursery mat out there between our shade nursery, our full sun nursery, and our nursery over here in the back. All different types of gingers and turmeric.
Oh, you sell gingers and turmeric. You didn't show me where those were. I would have had them in the video, man. What's up?
We ran out of light. So yeah, that's what I said. John barely scratched the surface. So you guys are going to just have to check out the website, check out some of my videos. Actually, I just did a nursery tour recently too. Cool. See maybe a little bit more in depth of what we're growing here.
Wonderful. All right. So if somebody wants to get something from your nursery, what's the website and your YouTube channel so they can watch your videos and all that?
Everything's through greendreamsfl.com, greendreamsfl on Yahoo, on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, the whole nine.
All right. Cool. Awesome, man. So anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode, seeing Pete's nursery and some rare perennial vegetables and even some fruits that you could get from him, he has such a large and amazing inventory that many of them below 3 gallons can be shipped to you guys. Please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, be sure to share this video, especially if you have friends or family in Florida. Give them this video because, you know, you can come pick up at the nursery. And honestly, Pete, if I was putting an installation here in town, I would just order all these plants and I would drop in, like, you know, five, you know, this plant, five of that plant in different areas. And I could literally have a built-in food forest from all the plants that you already have in stock. And I wouldn't have to like go hunt and pick. I go to so many nurseries in my daily life just to find this plant or that plant. And I mean, you pretty much, I don't want to say you have it all, but you have the most complete permaculture nursery that I've seen pretty much in my life, man. So thank you for having that. Thank you for having that for a resource. And I want you guys to utilize that. If you guys live in Tampa, St. Pete, you know, all these local areas, like just put in a big order, buy all these, get him to tell you how to plant them properly. And here's the thing, if you don't even know where to plant them, he also has services where he'll do consultations with you, so he'll set up a plan for you. And if you want to do them, plant them yourself, or he'll even do the installation for you as a whole full-on company to do that for you as well, especially if you're not into gardening, not into doing this, but you want to grow and eat food out of your garden. He could do a lot for you too. Once again, greendreamsfl.com is his website. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes. I've coming out about every 5 to 7 or maybe every 3 to 4 days, depending on my schedule and how I'm doing it, so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming content. I think I still have a few more episodes coming here at you from the Tampa area. Make sure to click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. Finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. I have many videos I've filmed here when I'm in Florida on vacation, and that may be applicable to you. Over 1,500 episodes now on this YouTube channel dedicated to teach you guys all the different aspects of growing your own food at home. Annuals, perennials, I don't care. As long as it's edible, it's going to show up on my channel in one way or another. With that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.